thank you for being here. I have enjoyed these 2 days, look forward to the chance to be back on this campus any opportunity that comes my way. I suspect you feel that way too. Those of us from Michigan, I know I can get an amen to a Michigander I was just talking to, we feel about two-thirds thawed now, having been out here for 4 days. We had real winter in Michigan this year. Highest ever snowfall on record. My mailbox was under snow. I mean, the mailbox stuck out of snow. It was real winter in Michigan. So if any of you have jobs in California, come to Michigan, come visit us. In this class, I proposed over 2 days to read the Bible with you. Not word for word, but to go through the grand story that is Scripture. Believing that if we understand Scripture as narrative, historical narrative, and read Scripture as historical narrative, Christocentrically, focused on Jesus, so that everything leading up to Jesus is prep for his appearance, his activity, and the climactic of event of his resurrection, that everything from that then flows out of, explains the significance of what he's done, and tells us what it means to us to be enlisted in that story, to be his disciples. There are recurring themes in God's great big story. The constantly recurring themes are things like going away and coming back, apostasy, discipline, and repentance, pardon. Captivity, liberation. Those are different metaphors for the same sort of thing that we human beings do to ourselves. And so we looked at the Old Testament story yesterday, and today we'll pick the story up. But let me begin with the story of my granddaughter. My granddaughter graduates high school next month. When she was 4 years old, her father is an artist. Her mother, our daughter, is an artsy person, and that drew David and Michelle together. And they created Shelly, and Shelly has that artistic bent and temperament, and I think she'll probably use it in her adult life, perhaps a career out of that. But at any rate, my wife and I are not particularly artistic, aesthetic, but we bought at a rummage sale a big table book of Norman Rockwell illustrations. It's a big plate book, and you know, you have to be sort of careful turning those pages, or they'll tear, and they're reproductions that you could actually take out of the book. We haven't framed. We've used it for years in our den. Well, Shelley, at four, was attracted to that book. Color and pictures and just a natural for her. So she said, "Poppy, can I see those pictures?" So I said, "Sure, sweetie, but let me turn the pages for you." Age four, motor skills are not, you know, real sharp, and she'd try to turn them. But may I turn the pages for you? Okay. So we laid it out on a little hammock, so it was down at her level, and she's looking front on, and I'm at the top, and so we get to about the fourth picture. And the fourth picture is called The Doctor's Office. And we get to that page, and Shelley does a bit of, you know, a wide-eyed. Well, I continued turning pages, and we got to two or three later pictures. She said, "Poppy, can we go back to that picture?" I said, "Which one, sweetie, are you talking about?" "Well, that boy." And so, okay, this time, she leaned in, and she was taking in details. So she looks up at me, and I take that as a signal. I turn some more pages. About that time, Myra walks in. She said, "What you doing?" I said, "We're looking at pictures." And Shelley said, "Poppy, can we go back to that picture?" I knew this time which picture to go to, so I go back to this picture. And I look up at my wife and wink and smile. We know there's nothing prurient in the heart of a four-year-old. But what's so fascinating? Well, sometimes when you want to know, it's best just to ask, right? So I said, Shelly, what's so interesting about this picture? Her answer, I wish I could get in that picture. I wonder what's going to happen next. The identification was very real because her mom, her dad, taken her to a doctor's office before, and she sort of had a sneaking suspicion about what the doctor is doing over there, and she called it pins. Is he going to stick me with a pin? Well, she's getting into the picture. I start there today a little differently than sort of talking about meta-narrative and illustrations about how little narratives fit the meta-narrative. I just thought, well, Shelley's experience illustrates the same thing, and maybe it's a little bit better. Scripture is the activity of God in this space-time bubble between eternity past and eternity yet to come. And by His grace, we are called into His story. We are called to be players coming on stage to not repeat previous dramas. I think that's been a fundamental flaw in the theology a lot of us have developed. Which prior act are we supposed to reproduce? As time moves on, as history moves on, as culture changes, you address the situation of your time and place, and it doesn't look exactly like anything that has gone before, but what's your responsibility? Stay true to the storyline. And sometimes culture allows some things to happen more in keeping with the kingdom of God or with a greater challenge to the kingdom of God in your generation than there is any immediate precedent for back here. But if you're faithful to the storyline, you wrestle with it and you try to figure it out. I use the word, you improvise. If you've ever taken a theater class or if you were in a high school play, you know what improvisation is. You're given some basic information and then you're told X, and you're supposed to improvise at that moment with that much story information. What would you do next to push the story forward? I think of the 1950s and 60s, the church had to address the issue of segregation, racism, begin addressing it in this culture, not because it hadn't existed before, but because culturally in this nation we were in a situation where it wouldn't wait any longer, and there were social circumstances allowing it now to be addressed in ways it had not been addressed before. And we did some things differently than our parents and grandparents had done it. And that it was done, then it was done in the Middle Ages, maybe a little more like it was called to be in the New Testament, but never quite pulled off there. I think in this generation, and it's come up in this lectureship, it's at the fore in many of our churches for discussion. What about gender issues, male, female roles, and what about leadership? How much of the issue of slavery and gender and discrimination and racial distinctions was cultural, that had to be addressed in different ways and different. In the Old Testament, you have a lot of that distinction preserved. In the New Testament, you begin to see a lot of it challenged. And the question is, if we're true in the storyline to advance the agenda of the kingdom of God, what do we do in our time? Well, a little bit of a sidetrack just to say the discussions we're having shouldn't scare us. We should expect them. They're good discussions to have. But it's better had not in terms of going back to a proof text than to say, what is the methodology to advance the kingdom of God in this time, this place? Shelley's insight. But when we talk about meta-narrative, when we talk about a great big story to which all our little stories attach to find meaning, understand we're not talking about what postmodern philosophers, postmodern literary critics talk about, that narratives are simply human structures. From a Christian point of view, we argue that the story we read in Scripture, the story God wrote in Scripture, the story recorded there that God's been acting out across time and that comes to its focus in Jesus, it is not a tribal story. It's not a Western Hemisphere story. It's not a story for one race or people who volunteered. It's the true story, the single true story of what life is about. And in that story, it is a public story that we are called to embrace, not as a sort of idiosyncratic thing of people who choose to be Christian, but that really is the true story, and we're challenged by embracing it to be Christian, truly and authentically Christian. And so you can study the Bible in one of two ways. You can either look at it, and by the way, that's what a lot of us did in our academic training. And we were taught to atomize the Bible, break it down. We broke it down into language studies and this phrase and this word. Or you can stand within the story. Now, those are not necessarily at odds with each other. If you have the good tools, you can maybe place yourself better within the story. But it has been a fault of what's been called modern scholarship just to break the Bible down atomistically. And if you break it down into atoms and units and try to connect the dots, you know how you connect the dots? Out of your subjectivity. You connect the dots out of your time and place. You read your culture onto those and you justify who you are and what you're doing. The Bible, though, reveals Missio Dei, the language, God's mission for the world. What's God's mission in the world and for the world? God's mission in the world is to reclaim it to Himself. We'll go back to Act 1 in a minute. God created life to be very different for us than it has played out for us. God didn't mean for you to have made some of the mistakes you've made, for you to have committed some of the sins you've committed, for you to have suffered some of the traumas you've suffered, for death to have done this in your family, for cancer, for... God didn't create that as the initial environment. That sand was thrown into the machinery when we got into Act 2, and sin complicated the good universe God created and meant for us to have. God is not going to abandon His creation, though. He's not going to abandon the original purpose He had for creation. He's in the process of redeeming it. And God's mission in the world is exactly that. And so when we talk about for our lives or for the church, the mission of the church, I think it's really more correct to say the church is enrolled in God's mission. And our task is not just to focus on ourselves, but to be a place where God's mission of reclaiming everything around us with love and forgiveness and grace and mercy, challenging darkness with light, that's our mission because that's God's mission. And the church is part of God's mission. And so that activity is played out, I suggested yesterday, and I give credit. There's nothing original to this except just my terminology. A lot of other people talk about historical narrative, talk about drama or creating storylines. This is just my set of metaphors for doing it around the notion of light. The Bible opens that in the beginning God created the heavens and the earth was without form, and darkness, deep darkness covered. So the story begins. God steps in and says, "Let there be light." Act 1, life as it was meant to be, Eden, paradise. That's what you and I were meant to be living in. A life where the relationship with God is open, free, unfettered. The relationship with one another is friendly. We don't have to lock doors. We don't worry about turning our backs. God is immediately accessible, and we are always into... That was what it was meant to be. Act 2, the darkness descended when we took the levers into our own hands and believe the devil's lie that maybe God was holding out on us and that if we'd just take over and run the place for ourselves, it would be better. Nah. But God didn't turn His back. God, Act 3, Genesis 12 now, says, "Abraham, I need someone to be my agent of mission in the world to put my presence, the light I intend to be on display in the world in the darkness that has descended." And so Abraham is called, and at the beginning of Abraham, "I'll make you a great nation, I'll give you a land, I'll bless all people by blessing you." And so the mission of the people of God in the Old Testament was a missionary vision to be light to the nations. And we traced that yesterday. and it didn't work too well, because the people who were meant to be lights to the world became what? Chameleons in the world. And they took on the colors of the greed and the competition and the lies and the violence. And even during that period, though, the promise is the Messiah will come. God's anointed will bring things back to God's purpose. And so, as we're ready in a minute to make the transition from Old to New Testament, I connect us to yesterday by saying those first three acts, what we call the Old Testament closes as a story in search of a conclusion. It doesn't present itself as a finished narrative. The Old Testament closes with the notion of God's anointed, God's king, God's sovereign. He's going to appear, but he hasn't yet been identified. But when he does appear, Isaiah 9, verse 6, Isaiah, the fifth gospel, he will be the everlasting God. He will be the one who will bring peace onto the earth. Yahweh's personal presence had been withdrawn from the temple in the book of Ezekiel. Remember in the Old Testament, this brilliant light over the tabernacle and later the temple at the dedication under Solomon. Ezekiel, in Ezekiel chapter 8, sees that glory, that light, disappear. It lifts up and lifts off and leaves the temple. And there's no reference to that Shekinah glory of God beyond that. The Old Testament wants that back as the evidence that here is where God meets with His people. This is where God and His people interact. And Torah, it is a covenant. But Jeremiah 31 says, "But the days come that I'll make a new covenant with the house of Israel and the house of Judah, not like the one I made with them when I brought them out of slavery from Egypt. I'll write this one not on tablets of stone, but where? On their hearts." The Old Testament is still waiting for that to be fulfilled, and creation itself, Paul would say in Romans 8, is still groaning under what sin has. Sin didn't just affect humans, it affected the whole cosmos, put it under blight and curse, and made it groan. So the Old Testament, a story awaiting fulfillment, the Christian claim is New Testament is fulfillment. And the king, so much greater than David, that many thought surely was God's anointed, in some ways he was, but became such a failure, such a disappointment. King Jesus comes on the scene. He is Jesus' Messiah, and he is to be confessed as that. And the new temple is his body. And that body of his own presence, God is now present as Emmanuel. We'll see in Act 5, it becomes now his spiritual body. There is a temple, but it's not mortar and marble. It's a new covenant now, written indeed on hearts, and the new creation is dawning. It's already beginning to appear. It's not yet here in fullness, but it's coming. So somebody who can sing, lead that one and listen to the refrain as we get to it, and we'll pick up the story there. Anybody, volunteer, go. Runs, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine, heir of salvation, purchase of God, born of His Spirit, washed in His blood. This is your story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Between those two testaments, there's a 400-year gap. I'm not going to fill it in, but I want you to be aware. And in that 400-year gap, lots of things happen. And from the time the Old Testament closes, what empire is dominant in the world when the Old Testament closes? Persia. What happens after the Old Testament closes? Who replaces Persia on the world scene? Greece. Alexander the Great comes and he goes pretty quickly. And after his death, four of his generals fight, two emerge, the Ptolemies down in Egypt, only to be sort of displaced and pushed back by the Seleucids up in Syria. And then this Jewish revolt under the Maccabees when Antiochus Epiphanes, Antiochus the Brilliant, his self-chosen name, the Jews called him Antiochus Epimenes, Antiochus the Jackass. But at any rate, Antiochus desecrated the temple by this Hellenization process that Alexander the Great started, forcing the Jews to embrace Greek culture, Greek lifestyle. Alexander had been trained under no less than Aristotle. Aristotle had been his teacher. Part of Alexander's burden was to Hellenize the world, to Greekize the world. And so Greek architecture, Greek culture, Greek games, Greek language, and that continues under the Ptolemies and under the Seleucids. And Antiochus desecrates the temple in Jerusalem in 167 BC by offering a pig on the Jewish altar and requiring that, altars be built in different Jewish cities around, and pigs, unclean animals. They get down to the little town of Modin, and a family rises up and revolt, a guy that they're going to try to force to offer the sacrifice, and he stabs Antiochus' agent trying to force it, and a revolt breaks out, and Judas the Maccabee, son of the guy who does that bold counter-revolutionary event, Judas the Maccabee becomes the leader, and there is this revolt, and the Jews are able to establish a degree under treaty with Rome eventually. Notice again, now Rome comes on the scene. Look at all the changes that have happened before Jesus gets here. Persia is dominant when the Old Testament closes. Some people are filtering back from Babylonian captivity. The Persians have freed them. They're coming back under Ezra, Nehemiah, Zerubbabel, rebuilding the wall and the temple. And remember the reaction to the temple being rebuilt? The old people cried. Why? The temple that was being rebuilt didn't have anything like the glory of the temple Solomon had built. The young people did what? They cheered without memory of the glorious ones. At least we have one now. I mean, but and so that's the way the Old Testament closes. Esther still off in Persia. But watch, the Greeks appear, the Ptolemies become dominant, the Seleucids become dominant, the Romans establish a treaty with the Hasmoneans for a degree of self-rule. But by 63 BC, preachers don't make good administrators, clergy don't make good governors, and so Palestine was so disruptive and unruly under the Hasmoneans, the Romans just took in and took charge. And so when Jesus comes, think of all the things that have happened. And now he's in a Roman world, and we had time, we'd talk about the Apocrypha, Mishnah, Talmud, some of the things they've done. But all of a sudden, Act 4 is ready to start. And by the way, you need to spend some time studying that intertestamental period. Do some reading about it. Because all of a sudden, you understand some of the institutions, personalities that Jesus steps into that in the Old Testament, huh? They're not back there. Act 4. The true light comes into the world. John says, John 1 verse 9, the true light came into the world and the darkness couldn't overcome him as they had the Jewish people. So in Act 4, the story actually, according to the Gospel of Luke, the beginning of the Gospel of Jesus Christ was not with Jesus but John the Baptist. John the Baptist is the first prophetic voice that has been heard in those 400 years. The Jewish people talk about the years of prophetic silence, broken by the voice of John. And what's John saying? Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is closing in on you. It's going to be available. It's at hand. It's so close we can reach out and touch it. He's actually a relative to Jesus. His mom, pregnant, not as a virgin birth, but miraculously, because Zechariah and Elizabeth had been trying to have babies all their married life and hadn't, and it's a miracle. Mary then, virginally impregnated by the Holy Spirit, Elizabeth and Mary come together and celebrate their pregnancies and wonder, who are these babies we're going to have and what is God about to do? The story begins with such high drama and songs that they sing about the babies they're going to bear and the prophetic voice that they are given about Jesus. Jesus says of John the Baptist, among all those born of women, there hadn't arisen a greater than John. But anybody who steps in and is part of this kingdom John is saying is at hand is even more blessed and fortunate than John. John dies under Herod Antipas, the dance, the head on the platter stuff. But do you remember that while he was in prison, John sends some of his disciples to Jesus to ask what? I said you're the Lamb of God taking away the sins of the world. I believe that. I've preached that. Are you really the one? John's a real character, fully human. I don't see any need to try to explain away the fact that in his pain and his anguish, in his aloneness in the prison, waiting to die, he has doubts. Jesus sends back word. Tell him what you've been seeing and hearing. Tell him to take heart. Then John gives way to Jesus himself, identifying Jesus, identifying him as the Lamb of God to take away the sins of the world. There are a lot of interesting things in the genealogy of Jesus. You know, we talked yesterday about the division of the kingdom after Saul, David, and Solomon, the one dynasty with eight good kings, the nine dynasties with not a single one in there. Some of those very failed royalties, like Rehoboam, the guy responsible for the division, because he was so arrogant. They're in Jesus' genealogy. There are these unlikely females. There are non-Jewish. I said yesterday, did you remember, in the Old Testament, God was never trying to save the Jews to the exclusion of Gentiles. That's obviously true. Jesus has Moabite blood, Canaanite blood, through people like Ruth and Rahab. And you have in there women like Tamar suffering such terrible personal tragedies, catastrophes in her life. Bathsheba, overpowered by the money, the wealth. You don't say no to a king in those days. And yet it's a sordid story. New Testament doesn't seem compelled to cover up the story. Jesus is coming to be God with us, but really with us, with skeletons in the closet and all of the. And so his family tree is traced in Matthew, I think through Joseph, so that legally he's established as the one who could be the Messiah. He is Jewish. And yet Luke is more interested, maybe Dr. Luke is more interested in Mary's story because of the miraculous event of the virginal conception. John, who writes last, says, well, let me tell you where the genealogy really begins. And he echoes Genesis 1:1 and begins his gospel in the beginning. Was the Word, and the Word was with God, the Word was God, and the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. The Jesus story is an incredible story. The virginal conception, I ask my freshman students sometimes, you think I don't use the term virgin birth, I think the birth was absolutely normal. The conception was the miracle. There was a virginal conception. Jesus squalled. Jesus. I had a lady walk out on me one time in church because I talked about baby Jesus being so real and pooping diapers, and so she just got up and left. She said, I will not hear this about my Lord. He's God with us. He really is human. I think the necessity of the virginal conception is what happens when John and Mary, in their love and in their marriage, procreate. What happens? A brand new person is formed, I think, at that very moment of conception. Jesus could not be a brand new person. He's been from eternity past. He needs a physical body, but he's not being created. And so a miracle is necessary at the conception so he can be given a body of flesh, but so an always existing deity can, but that's for another discussion. And for 12 years, or for the 30 years that he's growing up, between about age 12 until he goes into, or 25 years or so before he begins his ministry, he's growing up. John 7:5, his brothers, maybe the other kids in the family had sisters too. They think he's sort of weird. When he begins to make these claims, they use the term, he's crazy. Took the resurrection to convince even his own brothers and sisters. Well, how did Jesus present himself? These personal interactions with different people that are traced. The interaction with John the Baptist, the interaction with Nicodemus, the interaction with the apostles. Scripture was the background. Many people would say, look, we've seen and listened. We believe he's the fulfillment of Scripture. Miracles. Nicodemus said, what? We know you're from God. Nobody could be doing what you're doing otherwise. His parables, these teaching stories that, you know, the line out of the Matrix, splinters in the brain, that cause people to have to think about a different worldview of how to look at people and situations. And then his sermons. At the end of the Sermon on the Mount, the people said, somehow this sermon's different. He uses more illustration. No. He says, he teaches with an authority the rabbis don't have. The rabbis taught by saying, well, this famous rabbi said, and the other one said, Jesus comes and says, yeah, I know you've heard, but I'm telling you. This is what people have said in trying to interpret those words. I wrote the words. Let me tell you what we meant when we put that. Let me tell you that it even meant more than it said. When it said don't murder, what it was really saying was what? Don't even get on the path that would go there. Live reconciliation. It wasn't just about adultery. It was about keeping your heart pure. Don't look that way. It wasn't about Jesus' Sermon on the Mount. He does have authority. He says, you've heard it said. It's not contrasting Old and New Testaments. You've heard Scripture interpreted that way. Let me tell you what we were really saying there. The sheer brilliance of Jesus comes through in the various ways he presents himself. And then he drops the bombshell. These disciples, these apostles are so thrilled that Jesus is there teaching, fulfilling, opening up doors of understanding. And he says, by the way, don't let me upset you by what I'm telling you, but I'm going away. And so he did everything he could do to get them ready. And at least three times in the Gospel of Luke, he tells them, I'm going back to the Father. Raising Lazarus, he should have had them ready for even the notion that his death that would traumatize them so wouldn't necessarily be the end. So why were they taken off guard? You know, Mark keeps saying, well, they were just slow of heart. There was no precedent for this. And there was nothing like this. He comes and presents himself, not just to the select few, and the people kill him because they don't know what to do with Jesus. He threatens the status quo. They don't get it as to the kind of kingdom he's talking about. And of course, Jesus constantly, especially in the Gospel of John, talks about, no, I'm not worried. I know they're after me, but I'm okay now. My hour hasn't come. He was here on a mission, fulfilling Scripture, especially the New Testament preachers will say. Isaiah 53 is the favorite preaching text in the New Testament. It's either quoted or echoed more than any other text by these early evangelists and apostles to explain what Jesus did. And so they crucified him. Boy, some of the ways the artists have represented it. I don't see any blood. I don't see the guts and the gore. Real crucifixion was bloody and gory. His ankle bone from AD 21 that was found in an ossuary is the only physical evidence of crucifixion from the very time of Jesus that we have preserved to us. But we know enough about it in terms of how crucifixion worked. We know it was an awful thing. On the left is graffiti. That was found in the 1870s in Rome on the Palatine Hill. It's mockery of Jesus. If you can read, if you know a little bit of Greek, Alexamenos worships his God. Who's up on the cross? A human body and what? The head of an animal. It's mockery of Jesus. This is not Christian graffiti. This is mockery of the Christians. Alexamenos worships this phony God that we dealt with, that we killed. They beat him. These are actual lead weights off those whips unearthed at a Roman camp that was excavated in Britain a few years ago. But it was all in fulfillment of what Isaiah had talked about, that we like sheep had gone astray, turned to our own way. We brought the darkness in when God tried to give us light through Torah and the descendants of Abraham. We turned away from His good pleasure. And so darkness appeared to have triumphed one last time. And darkness prevailed over the scene of Jesus' death, a thick darkness that had to scare everybody because it was at midday. But the darkness gave way to resurrection. And the climactic moment of the story. Remember yesterday how good stories are written? The climactic event is death and burial and resurrection. Resurrection is the moment of triumph. Resurrection is where everything is brought together. God is going to be served. And so Jesus now, having told them, and then I'm going back to my Father, He ascends back to the Father, and we begin the story in the book of Acts. And that story is, okay, you're the new Israel. And the new Israel isn't just Jewish. The new Israel is not just the DNA of Abraham. Well, it is in a way, but the DNA is not physiological. It's all those who have faith like Abraham's. He's the father of all who believe, Jew and Gentile alike for Paul. And he says, we're the new Israel of God. We've not repudiated the descendants of Abraham. We are embraced and we're called through faith to be lights to the world. And so Peter, in the first half of Acts, becomes the spokesman. The gospel goes to the Jews first and also to the Greek. And then Paul is converted. And Paul becomes the central figure in the second half of the book of Acts. And Paul is uniquely qualified, yeah, to present the gospel to Jews as the fulfillment of their unfolding story. He is a Jew. He was trained under Rabbi Gamaliel. He knows the story. But he was born in Tarsus, a free Roman city. He had Roman citizenship by virtue of his... You weren't a citizen of Rome because you lived under its authority. You were a citizen of Rome only under special circumstances. Paul, because he was born to those special circumstances, was a Roman citizen, unlike Peter, unlike Jesus, people who could be beaten at will, beat the confession out of them, crucify them. You don't have to have a just trial. It doesn't have to be reviewed in Rome. Paul's a Roman citizen. And Paul can go places Peter couldn't. And Paul had a sophistication growing up in a Greek city like Tarsus, a place where he was educated not only in Torah, but where he learned the language and the culture and the poetry and the need of the Gentile world. And so Paul in Acts, the story, as you sort of trace the story out, Paul, as he's doing all those things, is writing these things called epistles, where he's helping them. What's the downside of the story? What does the climactic event mean for those of us who are subsequent to it? What's the significance of it, if any? Paul says, we're living in resurrection life. And in these letters, he says, church, here's what that means. Church, you're missing it there. He writes to the church at Rome, and he said, you've been baptized. You were enlisted in a story. Do you not get it? Don't you realize what that means? What newness of life, what resurrection life is about? And so Paul travels, three preaching tours among these major cities. He goes there, the stories are told. I happened to be in Ephesus last year, I just had to throw this in. This is the big 25,000 seat Colosseum when there was all the ruckus about Paul being there. Stayed in Ephesus nearly 3 years. Demetrius creates the riot. That, you know, Paul is hurting our business. Great is Artemis, or Diana, of Ephesus. Artemis, the Greek name, Diana, the Roman counterpart. And that's the very arena. I sat and read that in the arena, and, you know, boy, what feelings. They sat and well, probably didn't sit much. They shouted for hours, Luke said, and most of them didn't even know why we're there. Kill him! He's causing a ruckus. I don't know if Paul ever went into this building, but it was there during his day. That's the public toilet. But probably he did. And so he finally makes it to Rome because at the end of his third missionary journey, he's in Jerusalem. And you see up here at the top, that building outside the temple compound, that's the Fortress Antonia. Soldiers saw a riot breaking out down in that area surrounded by Solomon's colonnade. And they rush down only to find that Paul is being accused of desecrating this holy place, bringing uncircumcised people in here, speaking against Moses. They rescue him, and then they're about to beat the truth out of him as to why, how he caused this. And he said, do you do this to Roman citizens? Whoa. Well, enough charges are made. He's kept under arrest for his protection. He's sent down to Caesarea. He's going to rot in prison, it looks like. Because Felix and then Festus, they want to bribe to let him go. They realize there's really just trumped up charges here. Paul doesn't want to rot in jail. And so when the transition is made to Festus and it's not going to get any better, he's a citizen. He says, I want my case reviewed in Rome. And he goes to Rome. And, some prayers do get answered in weird ways. Paul had always wanted to go to Rome. He'd written a letter to the church in Rome, said, I hope to come there and impart some spiritual gift. He gets there in the spring of AD 60. And he's able to write at least four letters that are known to us from that period of time, convert some people who are part of the imperial guard, keeping him under house arrest. This is where Paul was kept. I know it wasn't. This is a very nice reconstructed Roman villa. But the point is, for that 2 years, Paul was under house arrest, not in a place this nice, I'm sure. But he was guarded, but he had freedom. So he received people in Rome, answered their questions, taught, preached, gave them things to take back to the churches. He was released at the end of that review of his case in 62, and best evidence is that he went on another preaching tour, maybe his dream now of going into Spain. He writes 1 Timothy and Titus about events and circumstances of that. But there's a fire that occurs in July of 64, and when Paul comes back to Rome, the Christians are being persecuted by Nero. They're actually being crucified, doused with pitch, and Nero will occasionally light the night sky with the burning bodies of Christians. Paul comes back to that. It's not going to end well. He's arrested again, and he writes his last letter known to us, 2 Timothy, and he says, Timothy, I've fought the good fight. I've finished the course. I've kept the faith. It's all over. But there's a crown laid up. Tradition says this is the very dungeon in which both Peter and Paul were kept prior to their executions. Don't know if it was or not, but it's cold and damp. Make sense of Paul's comment to Timothy, please bring the cloak that I left. It's cold. I could sure use it. It's different from the first villa is why I decided to show you that. Well, Revelation actually continues that story of where this goes, because the persecution gets more intense. And in this Christocentric missional reading, obviously Jesus is at the center of everything going on in Revelation. And Revelation is not about, it's not an end times construct for some of you who've been taught that and you look for what's going to happen in Russia and China and Cuba and the U.S. That wouldn't have been a thing to those people. Revelation 1:1 says, that this is about to come to pass. It's to help you get through the stress and the persecution. If you don't know Greg Stevenson's book on Revelation, A Slaughtered Lamb, get it. It's the best thing on Revelation that anybody in our tradition has produced. The dominant story communicated by Rome was Rome and the Greek gods align with it, rule over this world, and do so benevolently. The proper response is lordship, is loyalty, obedience, worship. John says, no, our story's different. It's a Jesus story. We confess Jesus as Lord, not Caesar. That got him in trouble, got him persecuted, got a lot of them killed. And so in the apocalypse, you get the Christian take on history. It is God's story unfolding, and you read it as an apocalyptic drama where the first 20 chapters and 10 verses are about the immediate circumstance of Christians told under apocalyptic drama. God's going to give you the victory. You hang in. Be faithful even if you have to die for your faith. There's a crown of life laid up for you. And probably the mark of the beast is something like this. 26 of these have been unearthed and cataloged to date. These are the little credential pieces you got when you went before, as different emperors would require. This one's from the 3rd century, that you've proved your loyalty to the empire by worshiping Caesar, that Caesar is Lord and God. The Christians didn't have these. They considered that the mark of the beast. They didn't want one of those, and a lot of them suffered. They lost their civil rights. They got thrown into jail. Eventually, they were killed. Acts 6 opens up for us in the book of Revelation, beginning at chapter 20, verse 11. where John then rushes all the way to the end of history and he says, I've told you a crown of life is laid up. That happens in Acts 6 when God's glory is the light and New Jerusalem comes down. The new heaven and the new earth are finally realized and things are as they were meant to be. Act 6, folks, is Act 1 in the biblical drama. I don't mean walking around naked in a garden. But it is a substantial existence. It's not floating around on clouds in heaven. It's a new heaven and a new earth with bodies like Jesus had post-resurrection, real bodies, still even some scars maybe, some reminders of what God brought you through. But Paul says, sown in mortality, raised in immortality. Sown corrupt, raised incorruptible. All of the things that God originally meant for us to have, paradise lost, is now paradise regained. And if you want to read the story of the new heavens and the new earth, read some Isaiah 11, some Isaiah 65, some Romans 8. Everything now is redeemed and brought back into God's hands. And so we close by standing to sing this hymn. The Christian story says, go ahead and be standing. The Christian story says, we sometimes appear to be at a loss, in the minority, overwhelmed by the darkness because the values around us are not the values of Christ. But behind the scenes, Revelation, look behind the scenes. God's the one on the throne, not Caesar. Light is going to win, not darkness. Truth, not lies. This is our Father's world. And as we live in it in our generation, don't forget it. And don't fail to live those values because you want to be part of that experience. Let's sing. This is my Father's world. Oh, let me ne'er forget that though the wrong seems oft so strong, God is the ruler yet. This is my Father's world. The battle is not done. Jesus who died shall be satisfied. Earth and heaven be one. Lord God, we look forward to the day that that promise is realized. Keep us faithful to you so that we may live in the light of your presence for eternity to come. Is our prayer in the blessed and holy name of Jesus. Amen. God bless. Let's go over to the field house. Thank you.